That is recording.
And
sorry.
That's okay.
Where do I turn it off at?
When you want to stop, just come and shut the cover.
Okay.
So, and okay. That'll be good. And you're recording on Collaborate as well. And then if you text me when you're done, I'll download the archive class for you, and then I'll show you that again next week. It'll take a while to get used to it, because there's just several different steps to do every job. If anybody else dials in, Scott, you'll have to go over and make sure that all their red crosses are off. Otherwise, they won't be able to communicate.
Okay?
I think that's all we need. If you have any problems, give me a yell.
Thank you so much.
I'll be around the corner. I can come back. Okay?
He just goes off his mouth. He won't have to do the access code and provide a user like that.
I would think so. Yeah. Because the access code just gives like extra like homework and stuff, right?
Yeah, the really good thing about that part of it is that there is animation. I'm going to try to download all the animation onto the Blackboard. Things like the heart moving, breathing, of that nature.
Okay.
And some of those animations are very good. Hello again, Will. You've got Robin and Danielle here, and I don't know who else will show, but I'm just going to start over.
Okay.
Jimmy Valvano made a statement at an ESPN banquet one time. He was dying of cancer. And he said, it's important that you do three things every day. One of those things is to laugh. And one of those things is to think every day. And one of those things is to involve your emotions in your life. Things like crying, yelling, screaming, things of that nature. Jimmy Valvano was the coach of the North Carolina State basketball team, from men's basketball team, from 1980 to 1990. He was a tremendous influence on everyone in his life. He was a positive person. In everything that he did, he was positive. He went to win in every aspect of his life. I bring that up and I talk about that because I think it's critical that you understand as a person that's going to be a coach of how important it is to other people's lives. As a coach, you never know whose life you're going to touch, positively or negatively. And we hope that in this experience of being a coach, that it's a positive experience for people. Some of the most successful people in this country attribute part of their success to their high school coach, or their elementary PE teacher, or their college coach. So those people are very critical, and have been very critical in their life. And an exercise that you might go through just for fun is to find out what the physiological response of laughter, thinking, and crying would be. It's not a test, but it's something maybe you should look up and see what the physiological response is. This class is the physiological principles of training. My name is Dr. Scott Washburn. I'm a, by trade, I'm a chiropractor. I went to the to Logan University in St. Louis, Missouri. I practiced for 20 years in Clovis, New Mexico. Had a few health issues, and in the midst of that downtime, I taught here at Eastern. I taught biomechanics at an undergraduate level. Taught biomechanics at graduate level. Taught the science of human movement at a graduate level. And I taught a kind of a course that was mixed, graduate, undergraduate. It was a topics class in nutrition of biomechanics. So I have a deep passion to teach. Hopefully I can get this material across to you that in a way that's fun to begin with. Maybe we can laugh every now and then. Maybe we'll all get to think some, and hopefully we won't cry too much. But if we do, we do, okay? I want to go over the syllabus a little bit. It's pretty self-explanatory, but there's a few things. I don't have an office here on campus. So if you need to meet with me, I can meet here in the classroom with you. Or if you folks online, if you need to meet with me, just shoot me an email, and we will either get together via telephone, or maybe we can Skype. Will that work for you, Will?
Any of those should work for me.
Okay. All right. The text is Exercise Physiology Theory and Application to Fitness and Performance, and it's the 9th edition. I've got that listed on the syllabus, on Blackboard. You can order it as an ebook or as a text. When we talk about the grading for this course, we'll have 10 chapter quizzes. The first quiz will be on February the 2nd. You will be required to do an article summary. That article summary, the article will be picked by me, and I will give you each one probably a different article. And you will be required on the date of the final exam to give your article summary as a live presentation. As being online, Will, if you can't do that, if you can't meet that date, because I know you have some deployment issues, if you can't meet that date, then we'll work something out for you on that. There's a fit prescription that each one of you will be required to do. And on February the 2nd, I will explain kind of what I want done in that. Okay. And there's a midterm and a final exam, and combined they count for 100 points. Midterm will be March the 8th, and the final exam will be, the written final exam will be May the 4th. And what I will do is I will submit those to you online, and you will have 48 hours to return those to me. Okay? Does that work for everybody? I wanted to let you know for sure that next Thursday, I will not be here. I've got to be out of town at a conference that I've had scheduled since July. But what I will do is I will record the class for next Thursday, and I will put the PowerPoint on for next Thursday, and you can go through that. I think it's important because I am required as a professor to keep some sort of a role that if you are online that you check in and you let me know what's going on, because they check me. And if I have to be accountable to them, I want you to be accountable to me. Does that work for everybody? Okay. I want to start out by giving you the Scott Washburn definition of physiology. When we talk about physiology and exercise physiology, that we have to consider the biomechanical and the kinesiological external component that's going on. And when I think about physiology and I think about exercise and I think about motion, I think about the internal component that's going on. All of the aspects of the internal body happening to allow a biomechanical and a kinesiological process to occur. That includes the endocrine system, it includes the muscular system, includes the nervous system, it includes the cardiovascular system, it includes the pulmonary system or the respiratory system, it includes the skeletal system and bones and joints. So all of the things that are occurring internally have a direct influence on what we see externally. And that's, when I think about physiology, that's basically what I think of from a physiological aspect. This week we're going to go over, we're looking at chapters 2, 3, 5, 7, 8, 9, and 10. And basically what we're going to do is we're just going to basically review a few things about physiology and what it has to do with exercise. When we start with chapter 2, we're going to talk about control of the internal environment. South of me. Mm-hmm. Now let's talk about homeostasis. Homeostasis, for the most part, is what occurs in our resting state. An example of that that they give is arterial blood pressure. If you're sitting in a chair and you're not doing anything, and you're not angry, you're not sad, you haven't had some sort of traumatic event in your life, and you're just sitting there, then you're at a homeostatic condition. That's your resting condition. If you're just sitting there, your body temperature is typically about 98.6. And then we talk about a steady state. It's also a constant internal environment. But say we decide we're going to go out for a 1 hour run. And it's 75 degrees, and the humidity is 85%. The internal component of the body, the internal temperature, eventually will rise some. Your steady state should balance out, as long as you're not completely dehydrated, as long as you don't have blood sugar problems, as long as you ate something before you ran, at least an hour before you ran, you'll stay in a pretty steady state of temperature. But when we talk about steady state, it's not the resting state. Most feedback in our environment occurs because of a control system that we call a negative feedback or positive feedback in the game. Now, most systems in our body operate through a negative feedback system. I want to give you a few examples. One example is insulin. And the release of it, the hormone insulin, in the midst of a blood sugar rise. Okay? If the blood sugar is elevating as a result of something that you ate, then the insulin starts to secrete into the bloodstream. And as a result of that, the blood sugar starts to decrease. And that's the function of insulin. That's a negative feedback. Excuse me just a moment, we'll lift my phone. Positive feedback system is something like this. Say you have a cut on the surface of your skin. The body immediately starts to form platelets, and fibrinogen is released, which is also another hormone. Fibrinogen is released, platelets start to form, and then you form a clot. That's a positive feedback scenario. Now, in a negative feedback scenario, there's a constant that's going on. It's a constant circle. Every day, all day, your blood sugar has to regulate itself. And that's just two examples of that. Now, the gain on a negative feedback system, the gain decreases. And on a positive feedback, the gain increases. And gain is just a simple means of the body regulating itself in a homeostatic nature. Because see, let me go back to the cut and the forming of a scab or a clot. In order for that scab or that clot to occur, there has to be an increased gain in the release of fibrinogen. But once, when you talk about insulin release, once the insulin is released, but the blood sugar's increased, and the blood sugar decreases, then the insulin goes back down to normal. It's not releasing like it was. Does that make sense? You okay with that, Will?
Yeah.
Okay. This slide here gives you an idea of how a negative feedback system works. It works in a circle. Too little increases the stimulus. And then we try to say blood sugar is increasing. Then we try, the body tries to release the insulin. And then we come back over here to the control center, which is the brain. And we come back around. And the pancreas says, okay, blood sugar's back normal again, so now I can go back to a normal level. This slide here just gives you an idea of the how the insulin regulation works. When you see down here where it says animation, I will get those animations loaded. I didn't realize that I had animations until earlier today, and I'll get those animations loaded. So, in order to maintain homeostasis, in order to maintain a steady state during exercise, we have to think about the challenge that occurs as a result of that. Let me ask you this question. When you're exercising, is your pH increasing or decreasing? So you get into a more alkaline state, right?
Yeah.
It also has something to do with what we're putting in our mouth, which is also an important part of what we're doing. Some people never reach a true alkaline state because they don't put the right thing in their mouth. And they live in an acidic, a more acidic nature than an alkaline nature. But here, we're increasing the pH in a normal setting, trying to trying to maintain homeostasis. if you're running a quarter mile, eventually your O2 is going to be challenged, your oxygen is going to be challenged. So after you've been through training, that's going to be less of an issue. But at first, it's going to be a major issue. One of the things that we see during exercise is that we, as we train, our O2 requirements, maybe they're not less, but our lung capacity is better, our heart capacity is better, and we utilize that oxygen much better. And homeostasis environment, the steady state environment, is much better at that point. Talks about a control system that's capable of maintaining steady state during sub-maximal exercise in a cool environment. If you live in Fairbanks, Alaska, and yesterday the temperature in Fairbanks, Alaska was minus 43, and you decide you're going to go exercise, or go out and just go for a walk outside, that's not what we call a cool environment. That's a cold environment. So it's going to be, the control system is going to be much different. But say like tomorrow morning here, it's supposed to be 40 degrees. That would be a cool environment. And we maintain a steady state much better in a cooler environment. That we go back to the humidity and the heat, and it creates a larger problem with our steady state. Can you hear me, Will? Is the volume okay?
Yeah, sometimes it's a little scratchy. But I can hear you most of the time pretty well.
Okay. Well, chime in if you can't hear me.
Will do, thank you.
Okay. And then we go down here to a hot, humid environment where we talk about the ability to maintain a steady state, and it's much, much more difficult at that point. It's as difficult to maintain a steady state at 80 degrees and 85% humidity as it is when the humidity is 45% and it's 43 below zero. Because your body cannot function in an exercise mode at that sort of a temperature. So there's a difference between cold and cool, and there's a difference between hot and warm, and then the ability to maintain a steady state. Does that make sense to everyone? Okay. I spoke with my son yesterday in Fairbanks. That's the only reason I know what the temperature was. And he's a airborne infantry guy, and he's very into going to the gym. He walked 2 miles to go to the gym in 43 below. He said he thought walking would give him a little bit of cardio. I thought maybe that was a little extreme. So, and as you know, homeostasis in the cells, the disturbance of that results in fatigue. and eventually will not be able to exercise. And that's when you're what we call spent. You've had enough. And that's why that occurs. As you train people, and as you train yourself, you will find that the distance there, the time there, becomes greater, and you have an ability to go longer before you fatigue and before those cells cause fatigue. Later in the course, we're going to talk about protein synthesis and muscle activity when we get to the muscular system. And we will talk about the cell signaling event, the response that occurs in the midst of exercise, and how it affects protein synthesis, and why it affects the muscle's ability to not only increase in size, but to increase in strength.
Sorry.
Will, let me ask you, are you able to receive these PowerPoints on your Blackboard?
On mine, I haven't seen the PowerPoint.
I'm sorry?
Yeah, I haven't seen the PowerPoint.
Okay. Because I have posted them to Blackboard. I just wanted to make sure that you guys were getting them. Now, when we talk about bioenergetics, the real critical thing that I want to talk about, and we're going to talk a lot about this later on in the course, is about ATP. ATP, without ATP, you cannot function. You cannot live. Let me give you an example of that. You all have probably heard of cyanide poisoning. When someone is poisoned with cyanide, what occurs is that cyanide attacks the mitochondria of the cell where ATP is formed, and it virtually kills all the ATP, and that person dies because they're not able to. There's muscle tissue in the heart, there's muscle tissue in the lungs, there's muscle tissue in the muscles, in the skeletal muscles. All of those are affected as a result of the loss of ATP. ATP is formed by two major pathways. And one of them is aerobic, and one of them is anaerobic. Now, if you're running a short distance, if you're exercising in a very rapid, say you're running a 100-meter dash, you know I'm old when I say a 100-yard dash. But when you're doing a 100-meter dash, you're forming ATP as a result of an anaerobic environment. That occurs from glycolysis. It doesn't occur from the oxygen part. Now, when you're going on a long, steady exercise, for instance, playing a basketball game or playing a soccer game, ATP will be produced in an aerobic state. This semester, we will talk about anaerobic pathways of and aerobic pathways, and where and how the hydrogen is removed, and allowing for the ATP to be formed. Now, I could go through a big explanation of the Krebs cycle, I could go through a big explanation of glycolysis, but our objective in this course is to figure out how to make athletes perform better. Part of the requirement for this course is physiology, but some of you may not have that. If you want me to go through the Krebs cycle, if you want me to go through glycolysis with you, I will do that separately with you. But our objective here is to know two things. We want to know that ATP is formed aerobically, and ATP is formed anaerobically. And we want to know what those pathways are. Okay? These are the pathways that we would go over later in the class. We're going to talk about the aerobic and anaerobic pathways and how energy to perform exercise comes from those. Energy comes in the form of ATP. It's important that you know that. This slide once again reiterates that short-term, high-intensity activities occur as a result of anaerobic energy. And long-term, low, moderate intensity exercise, the majority of that ATP is produced from aerobic sources. Intake of oxygen. When we talk about a fit plan, which is something, a fit prescription, which is something you folks are going to have to do here, where we have to understand this interaction in order to develop those plans and understand if you're training someone with special needs, someone who can't physically perform in a quote-unquote normal scenario, then we have to understand how we're going to press that person to improve their physical condition. As a coach and as a person that will be working with people, you'll not always be working with athletes. And sometimes with athletes, you'll have athletes who have diabetes. Sometimes you will have high school athletes that have rheumatoid arthritis, or lupus, or scleroderma, or psoriatic arthritis. Those scenarios you will have to take into account when you're doing a fit prescription for those people, when you're trying to figure out how you're going to bring them to their maximum level of performance, or their maximum level of function. Don't for a minute think that people with those conditions cannot function, because there are athletes who have those conditions who do perform, and they perform well, but you have to learn how to operate around that. Now, chapter 5 talks about the hormonal responses. Can we name some hormones that you would think would be released during exercise?
Is that like adrenaline?
Adrenaline, cortisol, okay. think of one, Robin?
Serotonin.
Serotonin. Will, can you think of one? I'm sorry?
Anybody take testosterone yet for estrogen?
Okay, I want to ask you to repeat that one more time. I'm sorry, we're having trouble hearing you.
That's okay. Did anybody take testosterone yet?
No. No one said testosterone. That's a good one. What about norepinephrine? Epinephrine. Those are also hormones that are released. When we start talking about our ability to function at a maximum level, we have to understand that our body is in the middle of our steady state, in the middle of our homeostatic state. We have to understand that regulation of hormone release is very critical. Will, you mentioned testosterone release. What happens to the body if you take, say, testosterone injections and you're working out?
The body will eventually stop producing its own testosterone, produce more estrogen in compensation.
That's a good answer. That's why it's dangerous to start injecting yourself with hormones or start having to take hormones. That doesn't always happen, but it is one of the things that can happen, is that the body starts producing less testosterone naturally. Some athletes, many athletes in today's world who want to perform in a very in a much higher capacity have a tendency to want to increase the intake of those sorts of things. And it eventually becomes very dangerous. And I think as a coach, you need to be aware that that's going on. You need to be aware that that's going on with athletes and kind of keep a tab on that. What's one of the other side effects that can occur when there's an increased testosterone release if they're dosing with testosterone? Have you ever seen a woman bodybuilder is taking doses of testosterone?
Facial hair? Like flat chested.
Flat chested. What else happens with them?
Mood swings.
They get downright ornery and can become very combative. So that's something that you need to watch for. If you're working with weightlifter athletes or athletes that are dosing with testosterone. We talked about glycogenesis. Glycolysis earlier, and this is glycogenolysis, and that is a different thing. That's related to exercise intensity. And what happens to a diabetic? Because insulin is a hormone. When a diabetic starts exercising in a very intense manner, say they're playing in a basketball game that's very intense. What happens to a diabetic in that scenario?
Does their blood sugar decrease?
blood sugar decreases, and that this is one of the things that you notice. What can happen with a diabetic? Robin, you said you coached.
Diabetic coma, death.
Yeah, and
epileptic
seizures, death, coma. So you have to be able to watch for those things. If you know you have a diabetic that's an athlete that you're working with. Most of them who have been a diabetic for a while will tell you, I'm low. And that, what do you do when they're low?
Give them a candy bar.
Well, you can give
orange.
You can give them an orange. You can give them a candy bar. You can give them. It's very critical that you make sure that there's a protein carbohydrate balance there. So we want to make sure that you can give them something like peanut butter, or you can give them something like peanut butter crackers, because with the peanut butter cracker, they're getting a carbohydrate. But they're also getting a protein, and the actual blood sugar will level out much better than just doing a straight carbohydrate boost. Some people want to give them orange juice. Some people want to give them a Coca-Cola, and that's okay as an initial fix. But the problem is if you don't give them a protein with it, then they will be right back in the low pretty pronto. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. We good with that, Will?
Absolutely.
Okay. Talked about serotonin. Serotonin is also real critical with making sure that there's an intracellular calcium balance. You spoke about that, Robin. Since we're on the insulin issue, let's talk about glucose. It's maintained through four processes, mobilized through liver glycogen stores. Would that be anaerobic or aerobic? We're going to say anaerobic. Glucose through the FFA, and that's the free fatty acids, and in the adipose tissue, it spares the blood glucose. Is that through an anaerobic or an aerobic pathway? It's hard to say if you don't know about the Krebs cycle, right? If you don't understand about glycolysis. That typically occurs from an aerobic process. Gluconeogenesis, which is the reformation of glucose in the body from amino acids, lactic acid, and glycerol, and those typically are occurring from an aerobic state. And when you block the entry of glucose into the cells, it forces the free fatty acids use as fuel. Okay? Also, there seems to be a prevalence of thyroid disease, especially in this part of the country, in eastern Mexico. So you will see young athletes with hypothyroidism.
Why is that?
I think it has to do with something with the foods that are raised in this area. I think it has to do with the lack of iodine in the soil. I think it also has to do with the lack of iodine in our diets, period. And if you look nationwide, there's a strong predisposition to thyroid disease, and even in the very young. And it's becoming more of a problem all the time. That's a very good question. My personal thought is we don't have enough iodine in our systems. The problem with dosing with iodine is that you can overdose, and you can kill yourself by overdosing with iodine. So there's a lot to be said about dosing athletes with minerals. And I say liquid minerals for that reason, because liquid minerals typically have a very normal dose of iodine, you know. And we don't see people dosing with minerals at all. It's very uncommon in this society. Now, when you live in a place where people eat, well, if you look at Pakistan, where they raise, where there's a high, they harvest Himalayan salt, and Himalayan salt is full of a natural iodine. They hardly have any thyroid disease there. All of the salt that they use is Himalayan salt, and it's full of all of these minerals that I was just talking about. And so, is that the real reason? I don't know, Robin, but I think so.
Just since everybody has it, and they need more of it, especially people my age. Like, they're always putting on thyroid medicine and upping it, and then needing more.
And then the thyroid medicine, you get to the point where it becomes dangerous too. You know, when you start increasing the dose, you have to be very careful, because you will create all kinds of cardiovascular issues. And the problem with hypothyroidism in athletes, problem with hypothyroidism in the society in general, is that it kills the thyroid eventually. It will get to where it will not function at all. So when they talk about slow-acting hormones, thyroid hormone is one of those hormones. Cortisol, you talked about adrenaline earlier. Cortisol is a slow-release hormone. Growth hormone is a slow-release hormone. Fast-acting, it stands to reason when we look at epinephrine, norepinephrine. Those are fight-flight response hormones. Those are hormones that kick in the midst of a fight-flight system. When we talk about insulin, when we talk about glucagon, those have to occur in the system rapidly in order to stabilize the system and bring it back to homeostasis. It's not unusual to see a person who's in heavy-duty exercise who is not a diabetic go into hypoglycemia. We see that a lot, especially, I don't know, you might have seen that some with a lot of female athletes, where they would go into hypoglycemia during basketball games and get the shakes, and they'd not be a true diabetic. That's why I think it's critical that we teach athletes how to eat proper before they exercise, and eat proper, period. But it's very critical that they understand how to eat before they exercise, so that we don't end up with these hypoglycemic issues, either from a diabetic problem or just from strictly hypoglycemia. Building shakes. We just had an earthquake here. Okay. We've got Oscar on here. Hold on. Oscar, can you hear me?
Yeah, I think I can hear you. Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Okay.
All right.
I have a little trouble getting on.
Okay. All right. I just now noticed that you were on there. Sorry.
No worries.
Are you coaching this semester?
No, I'm just job hunting this semester.
Okay. All right, when we talk about another issue with hormones, we talk about free fatty acid mobilization. That's real critical when we talk about exercise. One of the big issues that you will see, especially with cardiovascular people that you're, say you're training or you're coaching people who are 40 plus and have cholesterol and triglyceride issues. If you understand these mechanisms and how important it is for the release of hormones into the system and how important exercise is to increase to decrease the amount of triglycerides in the system, it allows for your blood vessels to not form fat plaques. That's one of the reasons that we tell people to exercise, is so that they don't, because it actually helps in decreasing the amount of triglycerides in the system, which causes the fatty buildup. Now, when we go to the nervous system, and we talk about, first of all, I want to kind of review a little bit of the nervous system, about the central nervous system. What would that be comprised of?
Brain.
And spinal cord, okay? Then we have the peripheral nervous system. That's all the nerves that are coming off the spinal cord, right? Okay. In the midst of that, you will have afferent nerve pathways and you will have efferent nerve pathways. afferent nerve pathways go from the system, from the body, back into the central nervous system. Efferent, they go away from the central nervous system. So it's a circle there that's occurring that causes your body's ability to function. An interesting way of talking about that is with the muscle spindle fiber. Okay. The muscle spindle detects a stretch. And as it detects a stretch, then that's a sensory neuron action. It goes back to the central nervous system and says, hey, I have to do something here. And then it creates a synapse of the motor neurons, and it allows the muscle to contract, and it resists the stretch. Now that's a normal activity. What happens if there's a decreased amount of sodium in the system?
Sodium is being removed, lets the bridge form.
Exactly, yeah.
Between the synapse and the muscle fiber.
Yeah, it's an action potential. The sodium goes in, the potassium comes out. They transfer with each other. If you don't have enough sodium in the system, then your muscles go into a deep cramp, right? What happens if you don't have enough potassium in the system? Same thing occurs. You also can go into cramps. So there has to be a balance there. All of that occurs in the action potential in the nerve. Yeah, and Robin, when you were talking about the switch there, it's the depolarization, repolarization. That's what happens. It's a threshold. The potassium comes out, the sodium goes in through the nerve pathway there, through the cell tissue. And that's what's creating this action potential. If there's a lack of those components in the system, then you end up with a problem. There again, we go back to teaching people how to eat properly and how to stay hydrated and stay and keep from going into because what can happen if, say, you have an athlete who starts to dehydrate? What happens to their heart? Because the heart is a muscle tissue.
Doesn't it beat really fast?
It either starts to beat really fast, or it starts to beat fast and beat erratically. And you can actually, that's why sometimes athletes go into heart issues. And they can actually die from it. So it's critical that we keep people hydrated, keep them with these sort of minerals in their system. Okay? And this is the synapse that we were talking about earlier, where there's a switch there. And in the midst of that synapse, it's an electrical issue that's occurring. And when we talk about depolarization, repolarization, we're talking about a positive and a negative reaction, and that is an electrical impulse. And that's where you have the postsynaptic potentials. And you cause that synapse to open up or to close. And that's where you get a transfer of electricity. Now, this is something that's really on the forefront right now. Sports-related concussions. Let me ask you, Oscar, are you able to get the PowerPoints?
Sorry?
Are you able to get the PowerPoints?
Oh, yes, I'm seeing they're they go along with the video.
Okay. Sports-related concussions. I want you to tell me which sports are the most prevalent to have sports-related concussions.
Football and soccer.
Football, soccer. What's the other?
Boxing.
Good. MMA type stuff. Which is.
I'm hockey.
I'm sorry?
I said hockey.
Hockey? Okay. What about bull riding?
Absolutely.
Bull riding, bronc riding. Those two are very, there's a very high tendency to sports related concussions. As you're coaching athletes, it's pretty hard as a coach sometimes to say, you'll be okay. It's pretty easy to say that, but we have to be very aware of the sort of things that we're seeing now. It's important that we understand these signs and symptoms of a concussion. I think not only for testing purposes, but I think it's important as a coach that you understand these signs and symptoms of concussions. Headaches, nausea, vomiting, visual problems. In my office, last week I saw two athletes who were in the midst of a deep concussion issue. And it had not been addressed. Because, why?
They didn't recognize the signs.
They didn't recognize the signs.
And they didn't want to stop playing.
The athlete didn't want to stop playing. In one of the cases, the parents didn't want the athlete to quit playing. And in one of the instances, the coach didn't want him to quit playing. So, it becomes a very dangerous issue when we see these sort of things happening. One thing that they don't show here that I would say would be on a physical, in the physical category, that I think it's important that you look at their eyes, because sometimes you'll see one eye dilated and one eye that's not dilated. And look at their pupils and see what's going on there, because sometimes that can really give you an instant picture of what's happening with a concussion. These are very, very critical issues. We want everybody to perform. We want them to be the best, but we also want to protect people. Important that we understand this, that we understand what's happening with the brain and how the brain functions in the midst of fatigue. What do you think happens to an athlete who's been playing in a very, very strenuous atmosphere, is dehydrated, and is obviously very fatigued. What do you think happens to them from a brain perspective? Will, can I ask you that question?
I would say their brain is communicating exhaustion.
Okay. What do you think the response is of the person? I mean, from a physical and an emotional state, how would they respond?
I get tired into exhaustion.
Okay. Would there be anger?
Did you say anger?
Anger, yes, sir. There's a few things that happen in the midst of that scenario. There's sometimes anger. They get, and that's an emotional state that they go through. Sometimes they have malaise where they just don't care. They just flat don't care about anything at that point. And I think you might see some of that in soccer, where these athletes are really performing for a long period of time in very, very rapid atmospheres. And I think you get to the point, if you are dehydrated and you are fatigued, extremely fatigued, I think sometimes that's one of the things you need to recognize as a coach, that, hey, they don't really know what's going on right now, you know, and I think coaches need to pay attention to that. And I watched a young lady the other night at a basketball game, and you could tell she was physically very exhausted, and I really appreciated the way the coach handled it, because her parents were screaming at him for taking her out of the game. But it was very obvious that she needed to rest. Her brain was, she was in a fatigue mode. She was, I mean, very angry, very upset about everything that was happening. She needed a moment. And sometimes it's just a moment that they need to be rehydrated. They need to rest for a few minutes. And after they did that with her, she came back out and did well. But I think we need to be very aware of that going on as coaches. I love the statement here. It says, current research suggests that fatigue is related to both central and peripheral factors. I think that's certainly a very real statement. Central meaning the brain, and peripheral meaning the muscle and the bone and the joint tissue. all of those factors together can create big problems with an athlete. That's why proper training, proper nutrition, proper rest, all of those things eliminate or decrease the amount of fatigue factors that are occurring. During the course of talking about these sort of issues, we're going to talk about rest and how important it is that people get rest. We live in a society where people don't rest anymore. We're all too busy. We all have too many things going on. And if we get 6 to 7 hours of sleep a night, we're pretty fortunate, most of us. But when you're talking about training people, it's pretty critical that they also get rest, because this fatigue factor lack of rest is huge in fatigue. Why would exercising enhance brain health?
Increases the firing of the neurons.
Okay. Increases the firing of the neurons.
Better oxygen usage.
Absolutely. Increases the amount of oxygen into the brain. What happens if you take a person and talk about a stroke victim here? If you take a stroke person who's had a stroke, who is not wheelchair bound, who can't actually get up and do something, can you actually bring them into a state where they can physically do things? Right. For example, go for a walk, run maybe, that sort of thing assists them in not having to go back through another stroke. Maybe there's other things we have to take care of there, but exercise is very critical with those people. Speak about depression here. Do you see many athletes in depression?
No.
Not many. And that, I think that plays a huge factor. We also talk about it. It decreases the incidence of hypertension, which is high blood pressure. It also decreases, we talked about earlier, the amount of triglyceride deposits on the blood walls. Okay, so exercise is critical there too, on the cell walls, the blood vessel walls, sorry. These days, somebody's going to shut that door and the whole building's going to fall down.
It might.
All right. When we talk about skeletal muscle, I'm going to go down here to muscle cramps because we talked about that earlier. They say electrolyte depletion or dehydration. That's a lack of what electrolytes in the system. What do you think, Oscar?
Just the muscle cramps?
Right. What type of electrolytes would be depleted?
Sodium?
Would potassium be one of them?
Yeah, potassium.
No. Anything else?
So those are the main ones that I...
Those are the main ones. Occasionally we see people with what we call hypocalcemia, where they have a decreased amount of calcium in their system, and they also end up with cramps, but that's pretty rare. That's a pretty rare situation. Typically, let me ask you this. If you have an athlete who goes into a deep muscle cramp in their thigh, how do you respond to that as a coach in that scenario. What about it, Will?
Start giving them tips of water, hopefully with some electrolytes in there, so you pass them.
Okay. How would you dose them with electrolytes?
I think that theoretically intravenous will not be ready. Like an IV is the most efficient way to get the electrolytes in your system.
Okay, I'm going to give you that.
I'm making that one as well, slower.
What if you don't have that available? What's the most commonly used?
Right, if you don't have what?
What if you don't have an IV available?
Having them drinking electrolyte fluid, is that what you're thinking now?
Okay. Can you think of two things that you would have them drink?
Water and Gatorade?
Gatorade, maybe, depending on how it's set up with sodium and potassium.
Like a Pedialyte?
Pedialyte, it's full of electrolytes. What's the big thing that they're using on these football fields now? Pickle juice. If they can stand to drink the pickle juice, it almost instantly stops the cramps. Now, if they don't throw up on you, you're pretty good. But some athletes cannot tolerate pickle juice. Another way of doing it, and a lot of people have great disparity about this, but I've seen it work very well. Another way of doing it is to have them drink something like tomato juice. Because tomato juice is very highly dosed in sodium and potassium. And it's almost an instant stop to that cramp. I have elderly patients in my office who refuse to drink tomato juice or pickle juice. And so what we do when they get muscle cramps in the middle of the night, which is very common with an elderly population, and you'll see that with if you have to deal with elderly people in an exercise atmosphere, you'll see a lot of muscle cramps in their feet, muscle cramps in their legs. The way I tell them to take care of that is to take a quarter teaspoon of salt, just straight salt, and lick it until it's completely gone from the spoon. They have to lick it slowly, but it will almost immediately get rid of the muscle cramps. Now you have to tell people that if they do that, they have to do it slowly, because if they don't, they'll throw up, and then you're right back to a dehydration state again. Okay? Have any of you ever heard of this? I'm telling you how old I am right now.
Salt pills.
Salt pills. We used to take salt pills when I was an athlete in high school. When we would have cramps, they would make us take salt pills, and it would decrease the amount of muscle cramps that we get. So, and that's why we dose patients like that now, is because if they refuse to drink the tomato juice, or they refuse to drink the pickle juice at home, then we try to dose them with salt. It doesn't completely fix the issue of the electrolyte depletion, because it's just sodium chloride if it's just regular Morton salt. But it stops the cramp for the time being. And then you can have them do things like the Pedialyte during the day, or you can have them do what's this drink that they're having people drink there? Cancer Ensure. Have you ever heard of Ensure?
Yeah.
Ensure has a high dose of electrolytes in it. So then they talk about neuromuscular control and muscle cramps. I think that we see some of this. I think sometimes in the world that I live in, as a chiropractor, we sometimes see patients who have muscle cramps as a result of impingement of nerves, and then that would be a neuromuscular control issue. But I don't think that that's the major cause, honestly. I think it's electrolyte deficiency, but maybe I disagree with them. Will you allow me to disagree with them? Okay. Now I want to talk about circulatory response. I'm going to go through circulatory response and respiratory response, and then I will let you folks go for the night. When we talk about the circulatory system, we have arteries, we have veins, we have arterioles, we have capillaries, we have venules, and the circulatory system is something we need to pay very close attention to in a coaching atmosphere. They talk about oxygen delivery to exercising muscle. The skeletal muscle increases. It increases because of what? How would a skeletal muscle receive more oxygen? I'm sorry?
Because it's working, obviously.
But how does it receive it?
Oh, from blood.
From blood. That's a primary objective of a red blood cell, is to carry oxygen. Okay? So, the cardiovascular response, the respiratory response, they work hand in hand. And that's why you want to increase their ability to intake oxygen more properly. What happens if you have an athlete who has asthma, exercise-induced asthma?
They need the inhaler to open the throat to get in.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. They have to do that. Can those athletes perform as well as an athlete that doesn't have that issue? As long as they're monitored properly. Yeah. I'm trying to think of what pro athletes have exercise-induced asthma. There are some that are very high-profile athletes. Can you guys think of any?
Any high-profile athletes with asthma?
Yeah, with exercise-induced asthma.
Now off the top of my head.
Okay. I saw a guy the other day at a football game, at a pro football game, that was using an inhaler. I wish I would have remembered what his name was, but it just kind of struck me that there he was in the middle of the game. But oxygen is very critical. We get it's transferred via red blood cells to the skeletal muscle tissue. If we have an increased cardiac output, which occurs during exercise, then we have to, in order for the muscles to work properly, they have to receive more oxygen. So we have a redistribution of blood flow, and you'll see in the midst of that, I think you'll see an ability of the muscle to, over time, to function much better, just simply because they're receiving more oxygen, their cardiac output. But and here's one of the answers to your questions, Dan. You know, vasal dilation during exercise, blood cell opens up, and then it decreases with less exercise. Okay. This is one of my favorites right now because I'm doing a lot of study on this. It's called nitric oxide. Nitric oxide is a huge issue in sports, high profile sports athletes right now. How are they receiving an increased dose of nitric oxide? Does anybody know?
In supplements,
yes, sir. It's really odd that they receive it from beet juice.
I've heard of that too in writing.
Yeah. You look at some of these athletes that are doing these, I can't remember what the, you know, these events where they run 26 miles and then they ride a bicycle for 100 miles and they swim 2 or 3 miles. Is that called
a triathlete?
Many triathletes now are taking what they call Beet Elite. And what that Beet Elite does is it increases the amount of nitric oxide in their system and it strengthens their muscles. So what happens over the age of 40 is that the human body starts decreasing the amount of nitric oxide that we're producing. So not only does it promote smooth muscle relaxation, and increased vasal dilation, but it also, you can take people with high blood pressure and put them on nitric oxide and it decreases their blood pressure. Yeah. And there's a lot of cardiovascular guys now that are putting their patients, especially people who are wanting to exercise and wanting to get better, they put them on beet juice so that they can help them with their blood pressure and not have to put them on high doses of high blood pressure medication. So nitric oxide, and I hope in the midst of our articles that we do, that I can find an article on nitric oxide, a scientific article that somebody can present on. Because I think it's right there. It's something that's really heavily used right now, and I think it's something. The great part about it is that you can have athletes take it, and it's not, you're not doping. They're not having to take testosterone or cortisone drugs to increase their ability to perform, and a lot of these triathletes are performing in amazingly higher levels, and that's the only thing that they're doing different. So you might look that up. It comes under the, I think the website is called humanin.com, and it'll talk about increasing nitric oxide in the system. Um, we're talking about heart rate and blood pressure changes, the intensity and duration of exercise. What happens to your blood pressure if you're in high, in an intense scenario in a soccer game?
It increases.
What do you think, Robin? Your heart rate increases.
Maybe it decreases because the vessels are dilated.
Yeah.
So would that cause a decrease?
Typically it causes a decrease. It's not a real dramatic decrease, but it's that steady state decrease that we're talking about. The heart rate increases, the vessels dilate, and you should have, and you shouldn't, your blood pressure should not be very high. But what happens, what are they talking about with emotional influence here with blood pressure changes? What would you think, Will?
I couldn't quite hear exactly your question. I know that we were talking about blood pressure and what happens in the beginning of the scenario.
Okay. What about emotional, if you have emotional influence on the blood pressure, what are they talking about with emotional influence?
Maybe the effect of anxiety on blood pressure.
Yeah, anxiety, anger, sadness, some people's blood pressure goes up when they get extremely happy. So, I think that's what they're talking about when they're talking about emotional influence. This is another issue that we're seeing some of now. It is uncommon. Can you tell me what might cause sudden cardiac death in an athlete, young athlete?
Probably failure of some of the regulatory mechanisms.
I'm sorry, can you say that one more time?
Failure of some regulatory mechanism.
My hearing aids are not working well, I'm sorry. But say it one more time, please.
Failure of some sort of regulatory mechanism.
Okay.
Probably due to the genetic issue.
Okay. It can be a genetic issue. I like that one because that is very common in people who die of sudden cardiac death at an early age. There's a few things that are on the market now that young people take that are creating some of these issues. One of them is the Accutane for acne. Matter of fact, over in Farwell a few years ago, there was a young athlete shooting a free throw in a basketball game, dropped dead, and he was on pretty high doses of Accutane. And they attributed his death to the use of the Accutane. Can you think of anything else that young athletes would be ingesting into their system that might create cardiac death? Very common.
High levels of caffeine.
I'm sorry?
Caffeine.
High levels of caffeine. How are they getting that?
Pre-workouts.
Energy drinks.
Red Bull.
Monster.
Those sorts of drinks are very dangerous to young people. They're finding that they're causing two problems. They're causing cardiac death or cardiac problems, abnormal heartbeats, or they're creating seizure. issues with these young people. So if you have athletes that are using those sort of things, honestly, I would have a strong talk with them, because I think that they're very dangerous, and I think the research is getting ready to show that they are very dangerous. And I think some of them even have a disclaimer on them that if you're under a certain age, you should not be drinking this.
I drink one every morning.
Yeah, most of us do, you know. I've never drank one, but I know people that drink them all the time. And so that's one of the, that's some of the causes. So we would say genetic, we would say Accutane, we would say possibly energy drinks. When we talk about cardiomyopathy, that's, you generally, in most scenarios, will not have athletes that you're working with in those situations, young people. If you do, their parents will usually know about those problems. If they're genetic or if they have had some sort of heart surgeries, you should know about that before you start taking them into an exercise event. In adults, CAD, coronary artery disease, and cardiomyopathy, those sort of things are, cardiomyopathy is atrial fibrillation, ventricular tachycardia, a condition called cardiac failure, which causes the heart to accumulate fluid around the outside of the heart. Most of those people are very easy to recognize because their ankles are swollen, their legs are swollen. And then when you talk about coronary artery disease, you're talking about high cholesterol, high triglyceride, LDL, HDL issues. Okay, let's go into respiration. They asked the question here, do respiratory muscles fatigue during exercise? There's obviously new evidence that suggests that respiratory muscles do fatigue. I think it kind of stands to reason that they fatigue, especially if you're in very, very intense workout scenarios. As we get into respiration later in the course, we will talk about onset of constant load, VO2 max. We will talk about the incremental exercise results. Tonight I'm not going to go real deep into that because I think that that's something that is going to take maybe a couple of weeks to go through. If you have any questions in the midst of all of this, don't hesitate to ask me. If I don't know the answer, I'll help you find out. Let's go down here on this one to maximum exercise. Let's talk about healthy individuals at sea level and healthy individuals that are working out at Denver, Colorado, for example. where you're at a mile high. What, can you think of two issues there with the lungs and the cardiovascular system?
Pregnant altitude helps you increase your VO2.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah, and what is the cardiovascular response to that? It increases the red blood cells' ability to uptake oxygen. Okay? And because the oxygen level is so much lower at a higher altitude. That's why you can take athletes and train them at high altitudes and they function a lot better. Do we have any questions tonight? Oscar?
Questions?
Got any questions?
Not so far.
Okay. Will?
No questions from me right now.
Okay. All right. It was pretty general tonight. Like I say, next week, I will record the session for next week, and I'll try to have them put it on YouTube for you. I will put the PowerPoints on, and I'll put the visuals on there. I mean, the animations. And hopefully we'll have all of the notes onto Blackboard for you by next by Monday, and at least for this class, and hopefully for next Thursdays. And like I say, next Thursday I will not be here, but I will film it and we'll get all that information to you. Okay? Thanks for being patient with me on this online situation. I'm trying to learn it. And I'm an old guy. And, like they say, it's hard to teach an old dog new tricks. But I'm trying to learn it because I also think I can learn it. So, other than that, guys, I really appreciate you. And it's nice meeting you. And we'll plan on, I will be back in the classroom on February the 2nd. Okay?
And we'll have our first quiz
will be on February the 2nd. Okay. I'll let you know through notes and through Blackboard kind of what might be on the quiz. And, it's very critical that you study the PowerPoints and my notes. And kind of supplement that with the book. All right? Okay. Thank you very much. Good night.
Good night.
You ladies know how to turn the music off?
Yes, I can.
She's smart.